Well, thanks so much for being here. We will definitely try to make things exciting for you. I'm Liz Alderman. I'm the European Economic Correspondent for the New York Times. And I'm really happy to be up here on stage in conversation with Yannis Stournaras, the longtime governor of the Bank of Greece, a member of the European Central Bank, obviously, otherwise known as the survivor, from what I understand, here in Greece. He's a man who apparently leads a very exciting life here. And hopefully I'll get to ask you a little bit about that a little bit later on. But, you know, generally speaking of survival, you have obviously been the central bank governor since 2014. Prior to that, you were the finance minister in 2012. That's when I started covering the Greek crisis for the Times. And basically, you have had a front seat to one of the most turbulent periods in Greece's recent history. Recession, record high unemployment, you know, bailouts, not to mention Grexit. These days, however, you know, the main threat is, you know, starts with a BR instead of a GR, and Greece is being hailed as a economic recovery story. You even got a pretty good upgrade from Moody's yesterday. So is this for real, or is this actually sort of the calm before a new storm?
It is for real, and thanks to many governments since 2010 that Greece is a recovery story. Well, these have been turbulent years, very interesting for me. I think we managed to turn around a difficult situation. Huge twin deficits have become surpluses now. We have improved competitiveness. But of course, this is not the end of the road. It is the beginning of a new road, I think.
I don't see it as... Is it the beginning of a really bumpy road or a smooth one from here on out?
Well, in economics and in economic developments, developments are not linear, mm-hmm. as you know, and it is up to us not to have a bumpy road. Mm-hmm. So we should continue on the path of structural reform, of fiscal responsibility, and we should never go back to policies of the past.
Yeah, that is definitely a statement that your colleagues in Europe would agree with. Is that how effectively is that being carried out right now in Greece, though?
Well, the good thing now is that after many efforts, many changes, many political changes, I would say now that 80% of members of the parliament today are not only in favor of the euro, but they have supported policies to keep the country into the eurozone. So I can say that this is the most important, the most important result. So I feel that populism cannot find fertile ground in Greece, although there are certain skirmishes of populism again. But Greece is not the elephant in the room. Greece is not the elephant in the room in Europe anymore. Mm-hmm. I think.
Well, we'll get to those other
after,
elephants.
Of course, a lot of sacrifices, a lot of sacrifices.
Yeah, well, let me ask you about some of those sacrifices, because as much progress as Greece has made, as you and actually others have pointed out, and the IMF has already admitted a while ago, Greece did carry out pretty big sacrifices. When Greece finally officially ended its bailout last August, one of the legacies that was left was 30% poverty. And as well as a rise in child poverty. In addition, you know, there are issues with respect to the creation of new jobs here, a number of which are precarious jobs. There's also the issue that's confronting many European economies, which is also kind of a hollowing out of the middle class. I mean, given those structural issues, how easy will it be for Greece to tackle that? This is, you know, the theme here is inclusive growth. How easy will that really be? What's needed?
To tackle poverty, you need growth, and to have growth, you need productivity growth, and to have a productivity growth, you need reforms. So we should continue along the path of structural reforms. We have been laggards up to now, so we need to continue on liberalizing markets. We need liberal policies in this country. To support the triangle of knowledge, that is research, innovation, education, We need to bring together universities, research institutions with the private sector. We need to adapt to new technologies that are flourishing worldwide. And for that, we need reforms. We need to liberalize markets. We need the right kind of policies.
What are the top two reforms that would really help Greece, in your view?
I would say the public sector, to make the public sector more efficient, to adapt, to cut bureaucracy. The second reform, I would say, is land use legislation, because we can attract a lot of foreign capital, because we need a lot of foreign capital. Now we save 10% of GDP, we invest 10% of GDP, we need to invest 20% of GDP in order to achieve much higher growth rates, which are feasible, provided we have higher investment. But to bring this investment ratio, we need to bring foreign capital, because domestic savings, they can increase, but they cannot jump from 10% of GDP to 20%. So we desperately need foreign direct investment. And for that, we need to make the country attractive to foreign investment. Land use legislation. I mean, the Greek state, for historical reasons, owns a lot of land. So it can have private-public partnership and use the land it owns, the infrastructure it owns, as a contribution to attract foreign capital. Mm-hmm. So this is the two, I would say, top structural investments.
And what about, you know, obviously any economy, in order to, you know, stimulate growth, you know, you need money flowing. Can you talk to us a little bit about the situation, the situation of the banks here?
Yes.
Because, you know, a lot has been made of the idea that, you know, the banks that you've been obviously moving to try to clean up a lot of bad loans and everything, and yet at the same time, when you talk to businesses here, a lot of them still complain that it's very difficult for them to get credit. How can you stimulate growth if banks are not lending enough to people?
Well, banks in this crisis were the victims. They were not the initiators of the crisis. The initiator of the crisis were irresponsible fiscal policies, and that had a toll on banks as well. Banks have done their best. We managed to keep the deposits of people untouched, which is extremely important in the crisis. Now they have been capitalized well. They have been restructured. They have been consolidated. Of course, there's a legacy of the crisis. The biggest legacy is the mountain of non-performing loans. Mm-hmm. The reason for that is, I would say, 70% the recession, an unemployed person, somebody who had a good job and then found it himself or herself unemployed, could not pay her or his loan. Mm-hmm. So the 70% of the causes of the NPLs, of the non-performing loans, is the crisis. Another 20 to 25% is irresponsible policies to protect. I would say directly the strategic defaulters. Mm-hmm. I mean, those who have the ability to pay, but they don't pay. Mm-hmm. So banks now have embarked on a huge effort to reduce this big mountain of this legacy non-performing loans, and they have done well. Since the peak of March 2016 up to now, non-performing loans have been reduced by about 25 billion, which is a lot, but still the mountain is big. So the ratio of non-performing loans remains, unfortunately, 45% of the total loans, while at the rest of the Eurozone is at about 3.5%. Mm. So banks will not be able to reduce this huge mountain unless they are assisted by more systemic approaches. And these systemic approaches we have offered. There is one solution offered by the Ministry of Finance, the other solution offered by the Bank of Greece. These two systemic proposals have been sent to DGCOM, to the European Competition Authority, to approve. So I hope that this will supplement the bank's efforts to reduce the legacy.
Does any part of that plan involve following in the footsteps of, for example, Ireland and Spain?
Yes.
Selling that off to private equity firms, et cetera?
Exactly. Uh-huh. Exactly, it falls. Of course, the problem here is bigger.
Yeah.
So we need a more ambitious plan.
Mm-hmm.
But it follows exactly the mm-hmm. steps followed by Ireland, Spain, Cyprus now,
mm-hmm.
and Italy.
Right.
So we don't require much. We just want equal treatment.
Mm-hmm. Just one quick question about that, because in places like Ireland and Spain, where you know bad loans have been sold off, once the repo man comes calling, you know there are also obviously consequences for people who haven't been able to pay their mortgages. In places like Spain and in Ireland, we saw a lot of evictions, you know, after this happened. And I think here in Greece, you know, there's been a lot of protection from people being evicted from their homes. And is that something that would kind of change? In other words, the potential social impact of that, what is your perspective on that?
Greece has the most effective protection scheme. It has the most generous protection scheme in Europe. That was always the case. It's not only a result of the crisis. So we don't have homeless in Greece coming from bank policies. I mean, we protect the needy a lot. So it's not true what perhaps you implied in the beginning when you talked about poverty. Despite the crisis, mm-hmm. despite the huge crisis that would have devastated any other country, this country stood well because it had from the past the right welfare policies, and also the social nexus was strong. The family nexus was very strong, that protected families and poor people.
Yes, no, that is definitely a strength of Greece. You mentioned Europe just a moment ago. Let me ask you to put your ECB hat on. I know you guys are in a bit of a quiet period right now.
Yes.
But when you're taking a look at Europe, when we talk about elephants in the room, you know, obviously Brexit, as we mentioned earlier, and let's talk about Italy. Can you give us a sense of basically how badly do you think both of those things are going to blow up? And how badly, in terms of the thinking at the ECB, what are the biggest risks to Europe?
I cannot talk about monetary policy because we are in a silence, what's called silence period, because next week we have a monetary policy meeting, so we have a total prohibition of talking about monetary policy a week before. So I will be very careful, we'll try to be very careful. Certainly the situation in Europe has improved a lot. Europe, despite the initial architectural mistakes, which still remain to a large extent, made huge steps. Europe saved Greece. I mean, Greece received the biggest loan assistance ever in economic history. It's something that when I was finance minister, when I mentioned it in the parliament, many MPs did not like it, but I had the obligation to tell people the truth. Greece received the highest assistance ever in economic history by its partners in Europe, and in the best possible terms. So we have been extremely lucky to be part of the Eurozone. The Eurozone provided huge loans to Greece to avoid the crisis. And finally, we managed to get rid of the most difficult consequences of the crisis. It's true that despite the architectural problems, Europe managed to escape recession, to a large extent, due to the policies of the ECB. The ECB went beyond its mandate and followed policies which should have been followed by the states. So the ECB played a very crucial role in saving the Eurozone. We escaped the crisis. The Eurozone had growth rates of the order of 2%. Despite the problems that I mentioned before. Now, towards the end of 2018, we entered in a downward trend, not in a recession, but in lower growth rates. We don't know whether these lower growth rates are permanent or temporary. I hope they are temporary. To a large extent, I'm afraid, are due to trade protectionism coming from the other side of the Atlantic, which has made companies and individuals more conservative in their decisions. They don't consume a lot. They don't invest because they're afraid that the protection coming from the other side of the Atlantic is going to have a negative effect on their lives, on economic decisions.
I was just and here, ask you about the Trump effect.
And here I can say in front of the American ambassador that in economic history, it's very strange. The technological leader that today is the United States never wanted closed markets. The technological leader in history wanted open markets to sell its product, to sell its innovation. So having the technological leader imposing tariffs and trade wars creates a huge problem because the other parts will retaliate and the end of the story will be less welfare, perhaps recession, and that will have an impact on the everyday life of people.
How does that impact the ECB's job, what you're talking about?
I cannot talk about the ECB.
Come on.
Well, I can say that the ECB has followed a policy characterized by realism and flexibility.
What does that mean?
That means that we're not dogmatic, and we responded to the crisis by following appropriate policies.
Mm-hmm. Okay. This is I'll let you all, like the Oracle, interpret that. Anyway, speaking of the ECB, this is hopefully something you can talk about. Speaking of leadership at the ECB, Mario Draghi has also, you know, presided over a very turbulent period. Time is coming very soon for a leadership change. You know, a lot of people are asking questions. We've had Mr. Draghi from the South in the driver's seat for a while. Maybe it's time for a new leader to come from the North. What is your view on that? What country would a new ECB leader come from that would actually satisfy the southern countries that also obviously are going to have a say?
Well, it's not correct to have a geographical choice. So
no.
We should
There's
choose
no
the best. We should choose the best. There are many colleagues that can succeed Mario. It's true that Mario left a legacy, a very important legacy. To be an ECB chairman, an ECB president, you need a combination of qualities. First of all, you need to have a character. You must be brave. You must retain the independence of the euro system. You must be knowledgeable. You must have academic knowledge. You must be politically clever and diplomatic. It's like the definition of a good economist that Keynes described.
Right?
Yeah. But there are many colleagues or people from outside the ECB that can succeed Mario, but they must have the qualities of Mario.
Mm-hmm. speaking of,
I hope I'm not cryptic enough being in Delphi. Eh?
Yeah. Speaking of the jobs of central bankers, I mean, there is one thing that I'm curious about, and sort of looking at Greece from the outside, how easy is it to do your job here in Greece, especially recently? You mentioned a couple of buzzwords, brave, independence. What is going on?
But that's why I mentioned all these things before. These days, it's difficult to be a central banker. There is an attack on central bankers from east to west, from north to south, and I'm very careful in what I'm saying. The difference is that central bankers, they are the guardians of price and financial stability, and they have a mandate to be independent, because to support the financial stability, you must do and say things that sometimes governments do not like, because the time horizons are different. Usually, governments have shorter time horizons than central banks, and perhaps this is the main reason for sometimes having a conflict.
But both
academic work and experience has shown that the model of central banks we have now, that is independent central banking with 6-year contracts, and protecting the independence in the case of the Eurozone through the treaty, in the case of the United States, perhaps through other legislation, in the case of the UK, through other legislation, is much better than the policies we had before, that the governments decided monetary policy or financial or macro-financial policy just as part of the apparatus to win elections. Mm-hmm. That was a mistake. That's why we had huge inflation in the past. Mm-hmm. That's why we don't have it now. There's a lot of research that shows the superiority of the current system. So it is not a question of technocracy, it's also a question of democracy. Because central bankers appeal to people, their research departments produce research, and they say things as they see it from a long-term perspective to maximize the welfare of societies. Mm-hmm. And this is what I'm doing here.
That is what you're doing here. But I mean, you know, again, looking at it from the outside, how difficult is it to do that? I mean, we've seen, you know, certainly we've read with a bit of bewilderment, you know, elsewhere from outside of Europe about what has happened here. So the sense that central bank independence, you know, is under pressure here. You know, let's just come out with it. All the headlines about this telephone call that you had that was recorded. I guess you all know the story. I don't need to repeat it for you. But I mean, tell us. What happened? What is that like? And how difficult does that make things make it for you to do your job? Is that a normal thing to happen to a central banker?
Well, of course, it's not a normal thing to call the central banker and record the telephone call. It's not at all, I would say.
I think so.
I think this telephone call violated almost all articles of the treaty of the European Union about central bank independence. It violated the penal code in Greece, and it violated common sense. But it's my duty to protect the independence of the central bank. It's my duty to serve the central bank and respect the mandate I have, both the mandate which is enshrined in the European legislation, but also in Greece's legislation. And this is extremely important. So I have the obligation to behave in the way I do. I mean, just protecting the independence of the central bank. I'm not disputing with the government, because I have a clear responsibility and a mandate given to me, which is enshrined also in the statutes of the central bank. So if I would kneel, or that would be a violation of the treaty and the Greek law. So this is why I behave in the way I do, which is just do what common sense dictates and what the law dictates. Mm-hmm. And also, mind something. What I'm saying as a central banker has been worked out by committees in the central bank, in the ECB, in the research department, in the supervision department. It is not my ideas. I just, when I read the annual report, I just read the production of hundreds of people in the research department, in the supervision department, in the ECB. It's not my own ideas.
But can I just ask, I mean, do you feel that a kind of a campaign of intimidation is being waged against you personally, not only with this phone call that we're talking about, your home was also raided by authorities last year with respect to another case. I mean, how do you view those actions?
Well, I think I leave it up to the people and to justice to evaluate these actions. It does not affect me in any way. Nobody or nothing can prevent me from serving my duty.
I have to ask, what do your colleagues at the ECB say about this? Do they just come up to you and say, you know, I've never received a phone call like that before. What should I do if I do, or, you know?
Well, I can't. Well, I think they have reacted in the way that you have reacted. Mm-hmm. They are no, normal human beings.
Very cryptic. Well, anyway, you have how long left in this role? A year and a half?
About a year and something.
Uh-huh. Yeah. What are you planning on doing next?
Well, I will think over it in the summer, swimming. It's too early yet. Yeah.
Sounds good. Well, in the interest of, I've been told that I have to keep the trains running on time, so let me thank you so much for taking the time to speak
thank
with
you.
Us and to share yourself so openly.